Hello, everybody. Welcome to Macro Money. This is Ilya Spivak, head of global macro here at tastylive. And it is another big day of U.S. economic data that's in front of us. Not the kind of a big day that you typically see with the likes of CPI or NFP or even a Fed policy announcement, but a big day nevertheless. The markets have been absolutely sweating every little thing about this Fed policy outlook. And of course, U.S. economic data is the key input that drives that speculation and shapes the narrative. So as big announcements come, it will be absolutely critical to be prepared. What we're going to do here is we are going to break down what is coming. We're going to break down why it's important, where markets have been to show us that it's important, and see what the outcomes might be. So with that in front of us, let's consider. We have been this week looking at economic data that was, to some extent, soggy. Let's call it that. The Conference Board consumer confidence number was, in particular, disappointing. 102.9 and 108. The ISM manufacturing PMI number is something that was a little bit softer at the headline, not much. We got a move in the right direction, went from 4.74 to 4.77. So the pace of contraction in manufacturing eased, didn't quite ease as much as the markets thought. The key thing in that report, employment moved into contraction territory. So it slipped under that 50, accelerated dramatically. So we were looking for prices to continue to shrink, but at a lower pace. This gave us inflation on the march, 51.3. The upshot of all of this, coupled with hawkish Fed speak, has been that the markets didn't really find a lasting lead. Now, we could tip the scales here in the last day of the week with the service sector ISM number. This is arguably more important than the PMI for the manufacturing side, because services account for the overwhelming lion's share of the U.S. economy, 75% or so. With that in mind, we are perhaps going to get the straw that breaks the camel's back into the end of the week. So first, let's consider why this matters. Let's kind of get our grounding in what it is that we're looking to be the moving parts, the levers of what's going on. First, we have seen over the course of February a notable improvement in U.S. economic data, this week's minor disappointments notwithstanding. Take a look. You can very clearly see it. This is from Citigroup. This is an index of economic performance relative to expectations. So not absolute outcomes relative to what the markets thought was going to happen. If data starts to outperform, we get a reading above zero. Obviously, we're there now. And the further we go above zero, the greater the magnitude and the market moving potential of the surprises. So critically, this index is scaled by the capacity for surprises to move markets. So when you get an outcome that surprises up or down, and there's a strong price action response, that's factored into the index. The pull that data has had. Notice also that the decline in data that happened before this occurred tellingly from about late to mid-October and through to the beginning of last month. You will notice in just a moment why this is important. This is a chart of Fed policy expectations looking forward 12 months from any given day. So this is not any one particular Fed policy announcement, any one particular calendar period. This is, if I looked out for what is the outlook in a year from any given day, This is what I'm looking at. This is the implied rate in Fed funds futures. And then that's in the orange there. And then in the dark blue, what you're seeing is the OFR financial stress index. So in other words, how troubled are market participants, economic actors, by tightening borrowing costs and a higher rate of sourcing capital? Because that's really what we're talking about here. We're talking about making it more expensive to do business in virtually every facet that one can imagine. At the retail level, at the business level, at the investment level, sourcing money is becoming more expensive of a proposition, making people that much more likely to hold on to cash, that much less likely to splash out on riskier investments or purchases or expansions of businesses that they can't afford or that they fear they might not be able to afford if something goes wrong and they need to recapitalize through borrowing. So what you see in February, coupled with this shift in economic data, is another turn higher in that 12-month curve after a period of stasis. That period of stasis coinciding exactly with the pullback in U.S. economic data's performance relative to expectations. So once the data turns higher, rate hike expectations turn higher, and notably that financial stress index, which had been falling all through the period when the markets thought the Fed had reached a level of rates that it would stick with, that the end of the rate hike cycle and the place where it would peak had become visible. Once that assumption fell away, the pullback in the index around that assumption stopped in its tracks immediately. Why does this matter? Well, take a look at how that index of financial stress, for all the reasons we just outlined, behaves relative to the S&P 500. All of last year, barring the tail end of the fourth quarter, when we saw these rate hike expectations build and so financial stress increased, stocks fell. When we got that stasis period right here, where you see the blue line veer off down and the orange line hold steady, that veering gave us the rebound in stock markets from October, give or take, through to January and through January that we have been watching. As that index stopped, stocks turned lower. So this is incredibly influential, clearly, to the entire market narrative, the entire market direction writ large. We can safely discount other factors, in my mind, be it this or that outturn with the war in Ukraine, this or that situation with OPEC and what they might want to do with oil supplies, you name it, seems like an afterthought when this is what we're worried about. Because all of those sector, theme, geography considerations, like the reopening in China, say, all of them pale in comparison and are superseded by, should I even be investing? Never mind which sector or geography or theme. Should I even be expanding my business or committing capital to some sort of large purchase outside of my normal range of cost of living expenses? Should I even be doing that at all? Or should I be holding on to cash instead? Should I divest of some of my risky investments that are already out there, risky relative to cash, of course? Should I even have market risk in this environment? So this is absolutely fundamental. Now, Here's what's happened to the yield curve in February. You can clearly see the dramatic shift here. So before, the peak in this curve along the dotted line was somewhere under 5%. That peak is now very much over it. And it looks like we're going to be north of 5% not only this year, but well into next. You can see there, we're at 5.25% essentially, a year from today. So well into March of 2024. If we consider where the peak then is, it's somewhere between July and September. So 6 months from now has to line up with a Fed policy announcement. That Fed policy announcement isn't going to occur in August. There is no Fed meeting in August. So when we look at how this breaks down, this is what we end up seeing in terms of actual policy meeting outcomes. So you can see here for the month of March, the meeting later this month, we have fully baked in one hike. So you can see in the ARM column all the way on the right, that's the average rate move. So when we say one hike, we're talking about a 25 basis point move. When you look at what is then appearing in the percent hike cut column in the middle there, 124.7, is we have already baked in 100% of a 25 basis point hike, and then about a 25% chance for a 50 basis point hike. So you can see the implied rate delta, which is the next column over to the right, is actually larger than 25 basis points at 31. That's that increased chance of a hike. That's 50 as opposed to a 25. Looking at May, again, a second rate hike at 25, fully baked in, and an 8% chance for a 50. When we consider that there is a chance that we get a 50 in May, there's a chance that we get a 50 in March, it starts to make sense how it is that we only have 72% of a rate hike baked in for June, but the implied rate is already reflecting 325 basis point adjustments higher at 76. That's because the way you get there is you take that 25% residual, that likelihood of a 50 basis point hike, and you add it to the 72, then you add the 8.5 in May. And what you end up with is essentially 100%+ chance that we are at 76, give or take. So in other words, three hikes by June. So it looks like the sequencing might be here and there, but we are going to have three rate hikes between now and July. And then the question becomes, well, what happens then? So if you look at the situation as it's set up, we are looking at a peak rate of about 5.45, which occurs somewhere between July and September. And then things start to come back down. So it looks like December, January, we still see the possibility that we're going to give away at least one of these hikes. So we're back from a range of 5.25 to 5.5 to a range of 5 to 5.25 by essentially the turn of the calendar year. This is what the markets are currently anticipating. And here's the result. So focusing here on specifically what's implied for given meetings, you can see that here at the top is the likelihood of an increase in rates that's greater than earlier anticipated being reflected in the July and the September expectations curves. So you can see at the start of February, they pointedly shifted higher after a period of stasis, shock of shocks, mid-October and through the end of January, exactly where we had that stocks rally that we've been looking at. And once that range gave way and we moved higher, we don't see it anymore. The yellow bars on the bottom are the S&P 500. I've put a five-day moving average on it in the dashed line to kind of give a better, cleaner sense of the ebb and flow. And we can see that when the top two lines were moving sideways, stocks were able to rally. You can see higher highs, higher lows on the S&P. When they turned higher, the S&P pointedly turned down. So this is why this matters. This is absolutely critical. And we can see it very clearly in market action. Now, with that, let's consider what's going on with these ISM numbers. Here's manufacturing. This is what we've seen already. We see that the number came in a little under 47.7. I've marked it in the red accordingly. We saw a pickup in new orders, but they're still contracting. They're contracting at a lower rate. We saw employment tick into contractionary territory, but didn't really leave the range that it's been in since essentially the first half of 2021. So once we kind of rebounded from the worst of COVID, employment has been fairly steady. And this has really been a big story for the Fed to contend with, is they're convinced they're going to need to see some amount of weakness in the labor market for inflation to really come off. And here, we ticked narrowly below 50, so employment in manufacturing contracted in the last reading, but not catastrophically so and not off trend. And it's difficult to look at this and make the case that we necessarily are looking at sustainable deterioration. This is more like par for the course of recent months. The real eye-catching thing is the jump in the inflation index, the prices index, which had been falling with overall manufacturing PMI around this idea that we, of course, have had Fed tightening from around the place where all of this tops. Notice it all tops right around the middle of 2021, which is, of course, exactly where the Fed unveiled its rate hike intentions. It wouldn't then hike until March of last year, but it was in June of 2021 that the Fed jettisoned the idea that inflation would go away by itself because it was all COVID disruptions that would be self-healing, and said, no, actually, there's something structural here. We need to address it much more vigorously. And so that's the point where you see the pricing component starts to fall, the overall index starts to fall because the higher rates and their expectations start to crimp demand, new orders start to fall. We now have a very spirited jump in the prices component of this, which of course would scream that the Fed needs to go higher for longer on rates. But this is services, but this is not services, this is manufacturing. Here is the biggest part of the U.S. economy, services. Here you can see we are still seeing the price component very, very high, despite it being kind of lower now than it had been before. It's certainly come off. The speed of price growth has certainly eased, but you can very clearly see that it's well above the 50 line, and the consternation that the Fed faces continues here. We can see that there's been a very spirited pickup in new orders. Meanwhile, employment looks much the same as it does in manufacturing, basically flat for months on end here, since late 2020, early 2021. The expectation is the overall index will tick down a little bit to 54.5, still comfortably showing positive growth. What we need to see here in this release is, number one, does this inflation component here follow the lead from manufacturing and head higher? And secondarily, do we see a pickup in demand and or softening employment? If employment continues steady as it did in manufacturing, and if new orders don't absolutely plunge off a cliff, it seems like a decent bet that the pricing part of this is not going to be incredibly encouraging for folks expecting the Fed to end things sooner because inflation has been contained. Now, it is certainly the case that with about a two-month lag, the pricing component of ISM services has led CPI, has led PCE, even at the core. And that's what I have here. The core PCE is the most central indicator of inflation that the Fed looks at. Takes out all of the various volatile items that might throw things off and really gets at the heart of what is the trend in inflation. You can see that the topping here, with about a two-month lag, of course, occurs very clearly in line with the service sector prices index and would ostensibly suggest that more in the same direction might be next. However, if we see what this is doing against an even more timely indicator, there should be concern. The yellow bars here are the two-year break-even rate. That's the difference between nominal and real bond yields, in this case, near-term at the two-year tenor. And when you take that difference, you get the magnitude of the inflation adjustment that it takes to get from nominal to real. And so this is the market's real kind of ongoing, live, day in, day out inflation expectation. You can see that both PCE and CPI have lagged this by about 2 months, but that all of the major turning points are all right there. So when we topped on inflation and started moving lower, with about a two-month lag, CPI and PCE followed. What we see now, right on time, is as we start to get in recent months, late last year, those break-even numbers starting to shift back higher, the pace of decline in inflation slows, and in the case of the PCE outcome, even moved the other way. PCE actually ticked up a bit in the last reading. But of course, things get much more dramatic as we move forward. The two-year break-even is now well north of 3%. It is at the highest in months. We're back to almost the same inflation we faced essentially a year ago. And if this leads the CPI and PCE numbers by 2 months, we should be seeing inflation going back up here before long. If that shows up here as it did here, well, then there's a lot of argument to be made for a Fed that not only doesn't slow things, but may actually need to rethink where the terminal rate ultimately is. If right now we're talking about a range of 5.25 and 5.5 with a cut somewhere at the end of the year, well, the first thing to go might be that cut. It may be that we're still in that range come this time next year. And then the question becomes, do we actually need to be in a range of 5.5 to 5.75? And so there's a lot of room for speculation here still, but the dynamics here suggest we might be looking already at data that signals the Fed needs to continue to hit the gas. What have been the consequences? Well, we don't need to belabor the point too hard to see them. This month, or last month rather, it's already March 2nd, but through the course of February, these have been the results. Dollar up, stocks down, as we saw, and of course, gold down, because rising yields are understandably anathema to an asset that yields absolutely nothing in real terms. Something that made sense to own when nominal yields were so low and inflation, while low, was just high enough above them to make real rates negative and make owning gold make sense as a store of value. In this current environment, real rates are in positive territory, and every basis point that they are in positive territory, they are offering that much more return than gold, which offers exactly zero return in real terms on yield income. So not surprisingly, gold has fallen with stocks. If you were harboring ideas of gold being some kind of a safe haven, here's your counterexample. A safe haven would be moving inversely of stocks as the dollar is. That's clearly not what we are seeing here. So if these ISM numbers do show us the pricing component perking up and everything else holds unchanged, this could be what we see more of. If we add into the mix maybe a little bit of weakness on the employment side, as we saw with the manufacturing side, maybe a little bit more disappointment on the headline figure, well, then this could get very, very quickly in an even worse direction. And these moves could be amplified even more, because it would give us essentially the start of more acute pain from all this tightening coming through the system, starting to show up in the data, even as the pricing power continues to build, beckoning more pain ahead as the Fed continues to move rates upward. And on that happy note, this has been Macro Money for today. Thank you very much for joining me again. This is Ilya Spivak, head of Global Macro here at Tasty Live. We do this show Monday through Thursday, right after overtime with our friend Chris Vecchio, head of Futures and Forex at Tasty Live. Outside of those hours, you can catch me on Twitter opining at Ilya Spivak. I'm also on with Tom and Tony for First Call on Sunday evenings. And I'll be joining Chris for Futures Power Hour tomorrow at 3 p.m. Central, 4 p.m. Eastern Time as a guest. So if you want to hear more of this fire and brimstone, you can come and join us there. And we'll talk about what the ISM numbers ultimately ended up doing. Thank you very much for joining, everyone. Godspeed. Take care.